In the last lecture, I introduced state machines and explained how they are very useful and often allow us to write much less code to express the logic of a smart contract. And part of the reason is that there's a lot of sharing between on-chain and off-chain code due to the use of these constraints. And another reason is that a lot of boilerplate is encapsulated in the state machine machinery, like the handling of this NFT stake token. And in today's lecture, I want to give another example because the concept is really very important. So I want to show another example of using a state machine. And I want to talk about testing. So first I'll present the example and then I'll explain various ways to test that code. The example I picked is a contract that allows somebody to sell tokens. So the idea is that if I own tokens, I can lock some of them in this contract, set a price, and then other people can buy it and I get the money they paid for it. In the beginning, the seller, the person or party that wants to sell tokens, starts with an NFT. And it can be an arbitrary NFT and it will just be used as before to identify the correct UTXO that contains the contract state. The first step is for the seller to lock his NFT at the script address of the smart contract we are about to write. And I call that TS here for token sale. So you create a transaction, submit a transaction that locks the NFT at this address. And as datum, we will use a simple integer, which indicates the price of the token. And this starts off as zero. There will be several operations that the seller can do. One of those is setting the price to a different value. And in order to do that, the seller needs to submit a transaction that has the current UTXO as input and the updated UTXO as output, where the datum has been changed to a different price. So in this example, the seller set the price to 6 ADA per token. Another thing the seller can do is actually lock some tokens in the contract. So in order to do that, he has to create yet another transaction that has as input, again, the contract, the UTXO locked at the contract, and a UTXO containing some tokens that the seller owns, and as output, just the updated UTXO at the contract address, which now contains the provided tokens as well. So in this example, the seller provides 5 tokens to the contract. Now for somebody to buy tokens, there needs to be created a transaction by the buyer that as input, of course, again has this UTXO sitting at the TS script address and the buying price in ADA. So if somebody wants to buy 2 tokens, you would create a transaction that has as input the price 12 ADA and the UTXO at the TS script address. And then 2 outputs, one the updated contract state, where now the tokens are taken out and the price has been added, and one output going to the buyer with the tokens he just bought. Finally, there must be a way for the seller to retrieve tokens and ADA. So in this example, if the seller, after the sale, wants to retrieve all the ADA and 1 token, he would create a transaction that again has the script UTXO as input, and then 2 outputs, one with the updated script UTXO, where now some tokens and some ADA have been retrieved, and 1 to himself with the retrieved funds. And of course, this diagram just shows 1 example. So the idea is that these operations can happen in any order. So the price can be set several times, tokens can be added, tokens can be bought, and funds can be withdrawn in arbitrary order. I implemented this in this week's code and I called the module token sale. And let's first look at this type, data token sale. So that's the parameter I will use for the contract. It has 3 fields, the seller's public key hash, then this token, that is the token being sold in this token sale, given by its asset class. And finally, the thread token, or maybe the thread token. So in production code, you would use the thread token, But as it turns out, it's difficult to test when this threat token is present. So I also allowed it to be absent. And as I explained last time, this can go wrong because arbitrary people can send arbitrary stuff to arbitrary addresses. So in the real world, there could be more than one UTXO at the token sale address, and then we need this threat token, this NFT, to identify the right one. But for our tests, we can assume that there will only ever be one UTXO at the token sale address. So then we don't need the threat token, and that will make testing easier. And as redeemer, I provide exactly the operations we saw in the diagram. So set price to a new value. This is the token price in Loveless. Add tokens, where the argument gives the amount of tokens to add. Buy tokens, where the argument gives the amount of tokens to buy. And finally, withdraw. This is actually like best practice to just give integer arguments because now it's not clear which is which. So in this case, the first one is supposed to be how many tokens to withdraw, and the second one, how many Loveless to withdraw. And I have my helper function again. Loveless is that given a value extracts the amount of Lovelesses in there. I also used that in last week's code, I believe. And now the transition function of the state machine. So the first argument is the parameter. And then recall we get the state. And in this case for datum, we will use integer. As I mentioned before, the price of the token and the redeemer. And then we must return a maybe constraint state. So we return nothing if the corresponding transition is illegal, and just something if it's not. And then we must provide the constraints and the new state. And recall the state contains the datum and the value. So similar to last time, I split this given state into the value and the datum. And then I have the redeemer. So I pattern match on these triples in this case statement. And now I simply go through the four transitions. So the first one is for set price. And if I want to set price to a new price P, I only allow that if the new price is non-negative. And in that case, the constraint is that that must be signed by the token seller. So only the token seller can change the price. But that's the only constraint. And the new state. So now the new datum will be this new price P that comes from here. And I don't change the value in the contract. The second transition is add tokens. And here I demand that the amount of tokens to add is positive, so not negative and also not zero. And in that case, there is no constraint. I could, of course, have put as constraint that it must be added by the seller. But the way I see it, I mean, this contract is created by the seller. The seller will set up the state machine and create the UTXO in the first place. So everything is written from the point of view of the seller. And the seller, he does care that only he can change the price. Otherwise, a buyer could set a lower price and then buy. So obviously, the seller wants to be the only one that can change the price. However, if somebody so feels and wants to donate tokens to this contract, then the seller doesn't mind. Therefore, from the point of view of the seller, there doesn't have to be a requirement that he must sign that, as long as n is positive. So if somebody adds tokens to this contract, then the seller doesn't forbid it. Of course, in reality, probably nobody ever will, but there's no reason for the seller to allow that. That's why, in this case, no constraint is needed. And the new state, well, the price doesn't change, but the value changes by this amount of tokens. So it's the old value plus the value of the tokens that are added. So with asset class value token and this n, I get the value of adding n tokens. Third case is buy tokens. Again, there is no constraint. Anybody can buy tokens. There's no additional constraint on the transaction. And the new state, the price again doesn't change. And the value changes, so we have the original value. We subtract the amount of tokens that are bought, which, by the way, is again a positive number, so you can only buy a positive number of tokens. And we also add the price, and the price is just the Loveless value of the amount of tokens times the current price, which is this P. Finally, we have the withdraw operation, so n tokens L Loveless. So we insist that both amounts are greater or equal zero. One of them could be zero. Maybe I should have forbidden that both are zero, but it also doesn't really matter. Then simply nothing will happen. In that case, that does have to be signed by the seller, because only the seller wants to be allowed to withdraw from the contract. And the new state, again, the price doesn't change. And the new value is, well, the old value V minus the n tokens that are taken out minus the L Loveless that are taken out. So minus, that's why I have the negate here. And that's all. All other transitions are illegal. So in all other cases, I return nothing in the transition function. Now that we have the transition function, we can easily define our state machine. And in this case, we can use a smart constructor called makeStateMachine. And the reason is, last time we had to use the actual constructor of the state machine because there was one check to check that the commitment, the hash, agreed with the actual choice. That was something we couldn't express as a constraint. But normally you can express everything as a constraint, and then you can use the smart constructor. That just takes three arguments. So the first is the thread token, or maybe the thread token, which we have from our token sale type. Then the transition function, which we just defined. And finally, the function that determines whether states are final or not. And in our case, we don't have a final state, so none of the states is final, so we can use the constant function that always returns false. So the idea is that once this token sale state machine has been started, it will run forever. There is no operation to stop it again. So once the UTXO is there at the state machine address, at the token sale address, it will always be there. You can't remove it again. And that's it. So this gives us our state machine. And then there's the usual boilerplate. So we can turn the state machine into a validator function, like we saw last time. And then we get our typed validator with the usual template Haskell. And from that, we get the validator and the address. And we can also, as we saw last time, easily define the state machine client, which, if you recall, is used to interact with the state machine from off-chain code, from the wallet. So the client allows you to start the state machine and step the state machine, make a transition. Then I need one helper function that's also similar to last time, because I want to use these operations from the state machine library, but they all use their own custom error type, some SM contract error. And I want to stick with text as error messages. So again, I use map error and then show and pack an SM contract error to convert it to text. So now let's look at the off-chain code. First, there's a function that I called startTS, Stark Token Sale. It takes two parameters, the asset class, which will be the token for sale, and a boolean. And the boolean I call use thread token. So if this is true, we want to use the thread token mechanism of the state machines. And if it's false, we don't want to. And as I mentioned before, in production code, in real code, you would use true in order to be able to pinpoint the correct UTXO identified by the thread token. But because that complicates testing, I also have the false option, which will simply assume that there will only ever be one UTXO at the state machine address. So given these two parameters, I first need to create this value of type token sale, where I need the seller, the token, and the thread token. So the seller should be myself, so start TS will be invoked by the seller to kick off the token sale. So I need to look up my own public key hash as we did before. The token I have, because that was one of the parameters, which leaves the thread token. So now I have two cases. Should I use one or not? So if not, then it's easy, then I just use nothing. Recall this field was of type maybe thread token. So if I don't want to use one, it's just nothing. So I don't have to do anything and immediately can return nothing. If I want to use one, then as we learned in the last lecture, I can use the getThreadToken function to get a thread token. But because that's in the state machine library, the error type wouldn't fit. So I use my mapError state machine to convert the error type to text. And then I must just fmap just over it because this gives me a thread token. But in this case, I want just the thread token. So then I can define my TS, my token sale. And having that, I can get a state machine client. And now I want to kick off the state machine, so create the first UTXO at the state machine address. And as in the last lecture, I can use run initialize, which takes the client and now the datum and the value. So datum is the initial price, that's zero, and the value should be the zero value, and I can use mempty here because value implements or is an instance of monoid. So mempty corresponds to the zero value. And again, I have to use mapError SM to get text error messages. And I ignore the return value. Then I tell last just TS. So I think we won't really make use of this in this lecture, but if you wanted to use this for real, then other parties would need to be able to discover the value of TS in order to find the state machine. And that value depends on the thread token, which we use in a real scenario. So that isn't known before you actually execute this. So there must be some way to communicate the value out to other parties. So that's why I tell it here so that it can be observed from the outside. And finally, I just log a message. So now for the other operations, they are all very similar and all very simple. They are all one-liners, which again shows how nice state machines work if they are applicable. So all of them take the token sale as one argument and an integer. So set price, I just use run step. So in all of these four cases, I just use run step, which will cause one transition in the state machine. And I always have to give the client and then the redeemer. So the client is always TS client TS. And the redeemer depends now on which case I am in. So if I want to set the price to P, it's set price P. If I want to add N tokens, it's add tokens N. If I want to buy N tokens, it's buy tokens N. And if I want to withdraw N tokens and L lossless, it's withdraw N L. So this really shows how nice state machines are, how easy it is to generate off-chain code for them. So all the details, adding the correct signatures, adding the correct values, and so on, will be taken care of by the state machine mechanism. Now, in order to make that usable from the outside, I need versions with endpoints so that I can trigger these operations. And I use two schemas, so one to start, and then once the token sale is up, to interact with it. So the start will take a triple as an argument. Recall, in order to start, I needed the asset class and the bool, but I split this here into a triple. So the asset class is split into a currency symbol and token name, and then the boolean, whether to use a thread token or not. And for the use schema, it's what we expect. So the first three operations, set price, add tokens, and buy tokens, take an integer each. And withdraw takes a pair of integers, because I must specify how many tokens to withdraw and how many lovelesses to withdraw. And then I can define versions of these operations with endpoints. But we encounter a slight problem here, and that is that since the last lecture, the signature of endpoints has changed. So we must look at that first. So if we look up the documentation for endpoint, it looks much more complicated now. It used to be that an endpoint that corresponded to parameters of type A simply gave a contract of type A. And the behavior was it would block until A was provided from the outside. And then it would continue, and the result of this would be the A that was provided from the outside. Now it's different. So it's still an endpoint where the parameters of type A, but now there's an argument to this endpoint function. There wasn't one before. And this argument is a continuation. So that tells us, once we have the A, how can we turn this A into a contract with return type B? And then the overall result of this operation is something of type promise WSEB. So the W, the S, and the E are the same type parameters that we are used to from contracts. So the writer type, the endpoints, and the error type, and the B is the overall result. So what's a promise? We look that up. Doesn't tell us anything, but we can look at the comment, and it says a wrapper indicating that this contract starts with a waiting action for use with select. So promise is basically a contract, but a contract that first waits for external input. And we see there's an await promise function that takes a promise and turns it into a contract. So that's how we can get a contract back. But we also see that in particular select now no longer doesn't take contracts, but promises. So let's see how to use that in practice. First with the start endpoint. So the idea is that this should allow the seller to start the token sale over and over again if he wants to, maybe for different tokens. So let's start at the end. So endpoint, as before, using type application and the type level string, we specify the name of the endpoint. But now we have this new function argument that wasn't there before, the continuation, that tells us what to do with the provided parameter values. So in this case, the parameter values are this triple: currency, symbol, token name, and UCT, whether or not to use the thread token mechanism. So once I have them, I will use my earlier defined function startTS, and that took the asset class and this bool. So I can assemble the asset class from the first two components of my triple, and then the last component is just the UCT. So this line now gives me a promise that will block, wait for user input, and then continue with the startTS, parameterized by the provided values. Now I use await promise to turn that back into a contract, wrap it into an error handle so that if something goes wrong, the contract won't crash, but instead simply log the error. And then I use this very useful combinator from the standard Haskell libraries, forever, which does, as the name suggests, so given some monadic computation, it just forever repeats it. And the use endpoints are similar. So first of all, here are these promises for the four operations: set price, add token, buy token, and withdraw. So endpoint, and now the continuations, which show how to continue once we have the parameter value. So in the first three cases, the parameter is an int, and set price, for example, took the token sale and an integer. So set price TS partially applied, just the TS, is exactly what we need as continuation function from integer, the parameter value, to contract. Same for the next two cases. The last one is a little bit different because we have a tuple of two integers as parameter value, but this withdraw TS took two integers, not as a tuple, but just as two parameters. But unQuery can take care of that. That's exactly what unQuery is for. If we look at unQuery, the signature, you see it takes a function with two parameters, A and B, and turns it into a function that takes A and B as a tuple. So for example, if as function we take plus addition, which takes two A's, then if we have unQuery plus, that is now a function with one parameter, a tuple. So for example, we can do unQuery 3, let's specify it's an int, and 4, and we get 7 as expected. So we have these endpoints, so these promises, and now we can use select on those. Recall select now takes promises. So this will now be the promise that waits until one of those four will get input, and then commit to that one and continue with that one. Then using await promise, we turn it into a contract, and then again, we handle errors and we do this forever. So once one of the four operations is finished, it will offer all four again. In order to try it out, let's first use the emulator as we did before. So I define a run my trace function that again uses run emulator trace.io prime with a custom emulator configuration and my trace. We'll get to my trace in a minute. Let's first look at the custom emulator configuration, where again I specify an initial distribution that doesn't give only ADA to the wallets but also some other token. So the idea is every wallet gets 1000 ADA, and in addition to that 1000 tokens, where token is just arbitrary currency symbol AA and token name capital A. This these underscores make it easier to read large numbers, and they are provided by a extension, GHT extension, that's called numeric underscores. So we'll only use three wallets, 1, 2, 3, and each of them will have 1000 ADA and 1000 of these tokens. Now for the trace, first we activate the start endpoint for wallet 1. So wallet 1 will be the one running the token sale, owning the token sale. And as parameters, we give our currency and name that we defined here, so the AA and the A, so that will be the token that can be sold. And we specify true, so we will use the thread token or NFT mechanism for the state machine. So for this trace, that's possible. Then we just wait for 5 slots to give this enough time to start the state machine. And we ask for the observable state, which, if you recall, should be the token sale value that has been started, which in particular also contains this just thread token in this case, because we specified true here. And then there are two possibilities, that this M is nothing, in which case the token sale hasn't started yet or something went wrong, so we log an error message. And in the good case, the one we expect, we do get our TS of type token sale. So we just log a message, and now we can start the use endpoints. Remember, the use endpoints are parameterized by this TS value. So we need to know the TS in order to start the use endpoints. So we start them on all three wallets, 1, 2, 3. And then we call various endpoints. So first, wallet 1 sets the price to 1 ADA. We wait for 5 slots. Now wallet 1 adds 100 tokens to the token sale state machine. for the token sale UTXO. We wait another 5 slots. Now wallet 2 buys 20 tokens. And because the price at the moment is 1 ADA, that should cost 20 ADA. We wait another 5 slots. Wallet 3 buys 5 ADA. Wallet 3 buys 5 tokens, which should cost 5 ADA because the price is still 1 ADA. We wait again. And finally, Wallet 1 withdraws 40 tokens and 10 ADA. So originally there were 100 tokens, 25 have been bought, that leaves 75, 40 are withdrawn, so 35 should be left. And initially there were no ADA, but Wallet 2 paid 20 and Wallet 3 paid 5 makes 25. So if we withdraw 10, then 15 should be left. And we can run that in the REPL. Let's see. So here the start contract was started. We get the log message, start token sale, with all the information, in particular also about the thread token that was picked. Now we start the other three contracts, the use contracts, parameterized by this TS value. Here we set the price, we add the tokens, wallet 2 buys, Wallet 3 buys, and Wallet 1 withdraws. And let's see the final result. So Wallet 1 started with 1,000 ADA and 1,000 tokens and set 100 tokens up for sale, but withdrew 40. So 940 tokens in the end, that's correct. And it also withdrew 10 ADA. So this is roughly 10 ADA, and the discrepancy is due to transaction fees. Wallet 2 started with 1,000 tokens and bought 20, so that's correct, but had to pay 20, so it is left with roughly 980 ADA. Wallet 3 bought 5 tokens, also correct, and had to pay 5, so left with roughly 995. And this here is the script UTXO, the token sale UTXO. And as we said, so this is also correct, 35 tokens are left and 15 ADA. So our contract seems to work, at least as far as the behavior with this trace is concerned. But in order to come to that conclusion, we had to execute it in the REPL and manually check the result, which of course you wouldn't want to do in a production environment. In a production environment, you want to have automatic tests, for example, unit tests. So we'll look at how to do that in Plutus next. This is actually the topic of today's lecture. And there are various testing frameworks in Haskell, test harnesses that can organize your tests, label your tests, group them, and so on. But Plutus uses the so-called TASTY test framework. You can find TASTY on Hackage, and there's also an example. So basically, you have a main program that uses, for example, default main and then some tests. And tests are of type test tree. And as the name suggests, a test tree is a tree of tests. So you can group tests and have subgroups and sub-subgroups and so on. There's special support for tests in Plutus, and that is provided in module plutus.contract.test in the plutus-contract package. And there are various types of tests that are supported, but today we'll only look at two of those. One that works with emulator traces, and one that's much more sophisticated and uses so-called property-based testing, which we will look at next. But let's start with the emulator trace based tests. So in this module, there's the chapter on checking predicates. And there we see the connection with tasty. So there's this check predicate function. It takes a descriptive name of the test, then a trace predicate. We'll get to that in a minute. And then emulator trace, like the one we just used to manually test our contract. And the result is a test tree, which we just saw is the type of tests that Tasty uses. So by using this check predicate, we can produce something that the Tasty framework can understand. There's also a variation, check predicate options, where we can set some options. So there's one additional argument of type check options. And if we look at that, then we don't see any constructors, so they are hidden. And in order to access the options and set various options, you need these operations here. And they have this weird type that we haven't seen yet, this lens prime. And that is related to something called optics in Haskell. And that is a huge topic by itself. And whole books have been written about optics in Haskell. So I will ignore this for now, just show you how to use this emulator trace, and then say a couple of words about optics. Unfortunately, I can't go into detail there. And I find it a bit unfortunate that you are basically forced to use these optics in order to work with this library. It would, in my opinion, have been better to expose the constructor so that we could have, without using optics, interacted with this check options type, for example. But in any case, so this we can use here, this emulator config lens, to actually set an emulator config like we did before when we ran the manual trace to specify an initial distribution of funds. So let's look at this trace predicate now. And that specifies some predicate, some condition, some check that the emulator trace should satisfy. And this is then what will be tested when you run this test. And first of all, we see that there are some logical combinators. So you have not to negate predicate, and you have logical and to combine two predicates to the combination. So this combination will only be true if both of the arguments are true. And then we see there's a variety of possible trace predicates, various checks you can do, some checking some UTXOs and check that a contract has completed or not completed and so on. But as an example, I will only use one that actually checks funds. So here we have wallet funds check, which given a wallet and a value determines that after the emulator trace has executed, the funds in the wallet have changed by this value. And interestingly, fees are ignored. So we would have a hard time to write precise tests if we had to take fees into account, because we don't know exactly how high they are, and then we would have to like do approximations and so on. So it's nice that we have this available where we can ignore fees. But there is also a variation on this valid funds exact change where fees are taken into account. And as you see, there are lots of other available trace predicates. So if we go back to the module where I defined my trace, you see there's one additional function here that I haven't shown you before. And it's called tests, and it's of type test tree. And it uses exactly this check predicate options. And for the options, I want to use the same emulator configuration that I used before, that we also used for the manual trace here at this point. I showed you that earlier. So I want to do the same. But now, unfortunately, in order to set that, I have to use these optics. So let's ignore that for now, just this syntax works. So these are the default check options, and then I modify the emulator config in it to have this value. Then the next argument is the name, so I just call it token sale trace. And now I use this AND combinator to chain together three different trace predicates. And each of these uses this wallet funds change, where I ignore the fees. And I just say, okay, wallet one, after being run should have 10 ADA more and 60 tokens less. Wallet 2 should have 20 ADA less and 20 tokens more. And wallet 3 should have 5 ADA less and 5 tokens more. We can try this out in the REPL. I just need to import test tasty. And then I have this default main available. And I can do default main tests. And it passes and says OK. Let's see what happens if it doesn't pass. So let me just change value here. Let's say instead of 60, I have 50. And let's run it again. And now we see we get a failure. And it gives us a nice error message. It says what it expected. The funds should change by minus 50, but in actual fact, they changed by minus 60. And we also get an emulator lock that we didn't see before when the test passed. This is probably the simplest and easiest way to write automatic tests for Plutus contracts. You simply write one or more emulator traces and then use check predicate in combination with appropriate test predicates to check that those emulator traces lead to the desired result. And what you get is more or less traditional unit tests. Before I get to the second way of testing Plutus contracts that I want to present today, I want to give a very brief introduction into optics and lenses. And there are various competing optics libraries on Hackage, but the most prominent and also most infamous one, and the one that the Plutus team decided to use, is called Lens. And it's authored by Edward Kmet, who is probably the most prolific contributor to Haskell libraries. And you see already on the Hackage page, the overview page of the Lens library, there's this scaring diagram. And there's a whole zoo of optics. So there are lenses and prisms and traversals and ISOs and whatnot. And here's a nice diagram with all the operations, or some of the operations, that the Lens library provides. And what optics are all about is reaching deeply into like hierarchical data types and inspect parts that are deeply hidden in a data type and manipulate them. Let's look at a very simple example that I provide in module Lens that shows the problem and how optics address that problem. So let's look at a company data type. It's just a new type wrapper around a list of persons with a accessor called staff. And I provide an underscore in front of staff that has no semantic meaning. So it's just another letter in this case. But when dealing with lenses, it's just convention to call fields with a leading underscore. So we have this company type, wrapper around persons. Then person is a record type with two fields, name and address. When name is just a string and address is of type address, again following this convention to use underscores in front of names. And finally, address is yet another new type wrapper around a string with accessor called underscore city. So there's nothing advanced going on. That's basically first week Haskell. And just as an example, I define two people, two persons, Alejandro and Lars, with name and address. And finally, I define a company where the staff consists of these two persons. And now the task is to write a simple function, goto, that gets a string as argument and a company, and is supposed to create a new company, which you get from the old company by changing all the city names, all the cities of all the persons in the staff of the company to the given string. So if I apply that to IOHK and as string argument I use Athens, then in the end I should get a company with again two persons, again name Alejandro and Lars, but now both of those should have city Athens. And I mean, that is not very difficult, so you can easily do that. You don't need any advanced Haskell for that, but it's a bit messy even in this simple example. So if I implement this, go to there, so that's the new city and company, then I can use the old company and update the star field in it. And this is, remember, a list of persons. So I write a helper function move person, and I map this helper function over the list, over the staff of the given company. And now in order to implement this move person, I take the existing person and then use record update syntax to change the address. So the name will be the same as the name of P, but I change the address. And what do I change it to? Well, I take the existing address and change the city name to there. We can try this out in the REPL. So I can first look at the original company. And it's as expected. And now I can apply go to Athens to IOHK. And we see that the deep inside, I mean, a couple of levels down in the company, now we have changed the city names here to Athens and here as well. So we see that dealing with nested record types, even though conceptually they are not complicated, is just or can be quite messy because you always have to like keep the old fields in place and update the new ones. And if it's nested, it can be quite messy. And this is exactly what optics try to solve and make easier. The idea is to provide something like first class field accessors. And in the end, it's almost as easy or it's very similar to dealing with such data types in Haskell than it is in an imperative language with mutable data types using these dot accessors. So in C sharp or in Java, you could write something like company.staff.name or .address.city, for example. And with lenses, it looks very similar. So in that sense, when I introduced monads, I said that some people say that monads offer a programmable semicolon, because the semicolon is normally what's used in a lot of programming languages to chain statements together. And with a monad, you can customize how this chaining of statements works. And similarly, you can say that optics provide a programmable dot in the sense of an accessor dot, like in Python or Java. And in order to work with lenses, I mean, you can, if you want to, implement them by hand, but the lenses library provides some template Haskell magic to do that automatically, but that expects these underscore convention. And that's called make lenses, and then you provide the types for which you want these lenses. So I added these make lenses company, make lenses person, make lenses address. And the names of the lenses will be the names of the original fields without the underscore. So that's why there is this convention. The fields will have the underscore and the lenses won't. There's a way to inspect what code template Haskell writes at compile time from the REPL. For that, you can activate a flag called ddump blyces. Now, if I reload, nothing happens. I think I must change the code. So let me just do this. Okay, and there we go. So this is now what template Haskell does. So we see the make lenses for company gives us a staff ISO. So that's a type of optic from company to list of person. Then make lenses person gives us an address lens from person to address, a name lens from person to string. And finally, make lenses address gives us a city ISO from address to string. And ISO and lens are two different types of optics, but the like convention or the order of type arguments is always the same. So you always have two type arguments, at least for these primed varieties. There are also more general optics with four type parameters, but these with two, the first one is always like the big data type. And then the second parameter is the one you zoom into, the part. So it's called optics because you can have this mental image of zooming into a data type. So the staff lens or ISO provides a way to zoom in from a company to the staff, which is a list of persons. The address lens allows us, given a person, to zoom into the address field of the person. The name lens gives us a way to zoom in from a person to the name, which is a string. And finally, the city ISO allows us to zoom in from an address into the city name string. And we can try these out. So if we take, for example, Lars and want to use the name lens, one way is to just look at the result of zooming in. So I can do Lars and then use one of these funny operators provided by the lens library. That's this caret dot and then one of the lenses. So let's take the name lens. I see I have to import control lens for this to work. Then I indeed get Lars, which is not very exciting, but at least it works. Similar if instead I use the address lens, then I get the address. So one very important feature of lenses and that makes them so powerful is that you can compose them. So using the address lens, I get from a person to the address, but the address itself is again a record type which has this city field. And I can chain lenses together if they are compatible. So I have something going from person to address, and I have something going from address to string, then I can combine them. And the combination is actually just the usual function composition dot, which is actually very cute because it's exactly like in a imperative programming languages with the accessor dot. And there's some quite advanced type level machinery going on behind the scenes to make that work, but it works. So I can just do address.city, for example, and now I zoom in two steps. So from the person, Lars, first to the address and then to the city, and I see the result, which is Regensburg. And you can't only view the result of zooming in, you can also manipulate. So you can set. So if I want to, for example, set my name to something else, I could do the following. So here the syntax would be this ampersand, which is basically just function application the other way around. So the argument comes first and then the function. And now a lens, so name, and now colon tilde and new value. So if I want to, for example, rename myself to all uppercase, I can do this. And now the result is a new person where the name has updated. And again, I can compose. So I can do, for example, name dot, no, not name, address, and then dot city. So I can reach into the person to the address and then deeper inside to the city and update the city from, for example, Regensburg to Munich. And it also works. So name and address are lenses, and lenses are, I mean, the intuition is that it's a part of a data structure, like the field in a record type. There's a different type of optics called traversables, which doesn't only zoom into one field, one thing, one smaller part, but into many simultaneously. So if you have a list, it would zoom into each element. So for example, I can use a list of integers, 3, 4. And now I can use the each traversable, which works for lots of container types, including lists, and can set every element to 42. And now I get a list with 3 42s. And the cool thing is that various types of lenses can be combined again with the dot operator. So for example, I had this IOHK type, the company type. So I can have IOHK and I can view the staff that we have seen before, but now the staff is a list. So now, for example, I can compose that with the each traversable. So now I focus on each element of the list, which is a person. Now I can compose this with address and that with city, and finally set it to, for example, Athens. Oh, I wanted to set, not view. So what I have to do is this. And this is exactly what this goto function achieved. So I reach into the staff, then reach into each person in the staff, into each person's address, into each address's city, and set it to Athens. So instead of this relatively messy code I wrote before using lenses, I can simply update the name of the city of each person in the company using this. If we go back to the code, that's exactly how you can implement this goto function using lenses. So you just update the company using this composed lens, or not, it's not a lens then anymore because there's a traversable in there, this composed optic staff dot each dot address dot city and set it to there. And this is actually what I did here when I configured our test. So this default check options is of type check options, but there is a lens from check options to emulator config. And I just wanted to change the emulator config. So I can use this and then this emulator config lens and set it to the value I wanted to have. So that's how this works. And that concludes the brief excursion into optics. It's a fascinating topic. I love lenses and optics. I think they are really cool. You can do very cool things with that. But of course, it's not the topic of these lectures. The second approach to testing Bluetooth contracts I want to present today uses a concept called property-based testing. And that is quite a revolutionary approach to testing that is much more powerful than simple unit testing. And it originated from Haskell, and Haskell, due to its pureness and its immutable data structures, is particularly suited to this approach. But it has been copied by almost all other programming languages by now. So you get property-based testing libraries for Java and Python and C# and JavaScript and many more. And one of the inventors of QuickCheck, which is the most prominent and was the first library using this approach, is John Hughes, who is also one of the original inventors of Haskell. And he and his company actually worked with IOHK to provide special support of this approach to testing Bluetooth contracts. But before we go to that, let's first look at vanilla QuickCheck for pure Haskell programs. In particular, property-based testing subsumes unit tests. So unit tests are just a special case. So we can have a very silly, simple unit test, something like simple prop, just of type Boolean, something like 2 plus 2 equals 4, let's say ints. And if I import QuickCheck, then I can test this property with the QuickCheck function. And QuickCheck tells me it's okay, so the property is true. If I modify it and make it false, then it fails. Of course, that is not very exciting. Oh, by the way, I see the convention is to call these QuickCheck properties prop underscore, not the way I did it. Let's change that. Let's also make it correct again. Now to see a more interesting example, here's a implementation of a sort function, sorting list of integers, which is using insertion sort, which of course is not very efficient. So the idea of insertion sort is you sort the tail of the list and then insert the head of the list at the right position. And this is a buggy implementation. And in order to test it, for example, a property that we could test would be after applying sort to a list of integers, the resulting list is sorted. So I define a helper function isSorted that checks whether a given list of ints is sorted. So the empty list is sorted, a one element list is sorted, and a list with at least two elements is sorted if the first element is less than or equal to the second element, if recursively the tail of the list is sorted. And using that, we can now provide a QuickCheck property like this, that is not just simply of type Boolean, but instead is a function from list of ints to bool. So you can read that like a specification or like a mathematical property. Basically, it says for all list of integers XS, if you apply sort to it, then the result should be sorted. And QuickCheck can deal with such properties. So I can try that in the REPL and apply QuickCheck to this new property. So it sorts. And it fails and it gives me a counter example. So it says for this list access, this property doesn't hold. So if I sort it, the result is not sorted. So I can try that out. And indeed, I get 0 minus 1, which is indeed not a sorted list. And in addition to that, it also seems to have lost an element somewhere on the way. So how does QuickCheck do that? So if you provide a function with one or also more arguments to the QuickCheck function, it will generate random arguments for the function. So in our case, because we have one argument of type list of ints, QuickCheck will generate random list of ints, and then for each of these random lists, check whether the property holds. And if it does, then the test passes. But if it doesn't, it will report the counter example. However, we see that here in this error report, it says after 8 tests and 4 shrinks. So this means QuickCheck tried 8 random integer lists and then found a counter example where this property didn't hold. But then it didn't simply report the list it had at that point, but it tried to simplify it. And this is called shrinking. And that's also a very powerful feature of QuickCheck, because often the counter examples, the random counter examples that QuickCheck finds are very complicated, very long lists with very long numbers. But then once a counter example has been found, QuickCheck tries to simplify these counter examples. So in the case of list of ints, it might try to drop an element of the list that it found as a counter example and check whether the property is still violated, or maybe make some of the numbers in the list smaller until it doesn't find a way to get an even simpler example. And this is really very powerful and very useful, because if you want to debug, it's very important to have not only a counter example, but a simple counter example, as simple as possible. So it's this combination of random test generation and shrinking that makes QuickCheck so tremendously useful. And actually, we can see what types of random lists QuickCheck generates. There's a function called sample, and this looks a bit weird, but bear with me. So the way QuickCheck does this random generation is via a type class, and the type class is called arbitrary with capital A. So we can actually ask for information on the arbitrary class. And we see there are lots of instances already. And we see it has 2 methods. One is called arbitrary, one is shrink. So arbitrary is of type gen A, and gen is yet another monad. And basically what it allows is it allows random number generation for values of type A. So it has various methods provided by the monad that allow you to do random generation. And the second method is shrink. So given an A, provide a list of simpler versions of A, whatever that means. That depends on the type, of course. And as I said, we have lots of predefined instances for this arbitrary class already. So in particular, we have one for int somewhere, and given an arbitrary instance for A, we also have an arbitrary instance for list of A's, and therefore QuickCheck knows how to generate random ints. And now if we look at the result of the sample function, that just in IO provides some of the random int lists that QuickCheck would use. And there we see something interesting, that the further we go down in the list, the more complicated the list becomes. So the first random one is just the empty list, and then we get 2 with just one element with quite small numbers, -2 and 0. And then we get longer lists, but the elements here are still only one digit, and we get simple ones again, but towards the end, we have like long lists with quite large numbers. So in addition to just providing random generation in this gen monad, there's also a concept of basically complexity. So not only if you implement that actually by hand, then you're not only supposed to somehow generate a random A, but also a random A of some sort of complexity. So a simple random A or a more complex random A. And then when quick check actually checks a property, it starts with simple random arguments and then makes them more and more complex over time. And by default, it tries 100 different random arguments to a given property, but that can be configured. So I think 100 is a good default for development, but probably for production, especially for complex properties, something like 1,000 or even 10,000 is maybe more appropriate. So that can be configured. Okay, and so we see that this random generation for int lists work, and in our example, we found this counterexample 00 minus 1. If we inspect the code, it's quite obvious that there's one bug here, because all we do for a non-empty list is insert the first element into the tail, but we don't recursively sort the tail. So we can try to fix this and test again. And now it doesn't find a counterexample anymore. So this property now seems to be satisfied, at least for the 100 or 200 test cases we tried. However, if I try the original counterexample that we found before fixing this bug, we see that we still, I mean, we get a sorted list now, but it's of course still not correct. And this leads to an important point that obviously quick check can't do magic, so the results are only as good as the properties you provide. And what we see here is that this one property we have, prop sort sorts, is not strong enough to detect whether the function is actually correct. So in this case, we do get a sorted list, but it's still the wrong result. So for example, we could add a second property, prop sort preserve length, which states that after sorting, the result should be as long as the original list. So what we could say is, for example, length sort access equals length access. If we try this, then we do find another counterexample, 0, 0. And if we check sort of 0, 0, we see we only get the one element list. And the bug is here, because if x is less than or equal y, we append x to ys, but we forget about the y. So let's insert that there and try quick check again. And it works. But of course, that is still no proof that our function is correct, because these two properties together, that actually the result is sorted and it has the same length as the original list, is still not enough to fully specify a sorting function. For example, the sorting function could simply return a list of the same length where all the elements are zero. So that would be sorted and it would have the same length, but obviously it wouldn't sort the original list. So it's quite an art to find properties that are strong enough to basically guarantee that if they are all satisfied, there is no bug. But nevertheless, this quick check approach is much more powerful than traditional unit testing, because it tests so many hundreds or thousands of random test cases and often finds examples that a human programmer that writes unit tests wouldn't have thought of. And with a few lines of code now, these two properties that I provided, I test hundreds of thousands of scenarios, which is much better than just writing two unit tests for specific lists. Now that we have gotten a brief overview of Quick Check, we will apply it to testing of Plutus contracts. But there we encounter a problem, namely, how do you use Quick Check to test side affecting code, code that has effects in the real world, like on a blockchain? And that problem doesn't only arise with blockchains, it arises with all systems that use I/O that have effects. And John Hughes himself always uses the example of, for example, a file system. How would you test file system operations, like open a file, write to a file, close a file, read a file, and so on, using Quick Check. And the approach one can use there is very similar to the one that is used for Plutus. And the idea is that you start with a model. A model is basically an idealized model of how the real world system should work. So there must be some sort of relation between the model and the real system. So if the real system is a file system, then you could in the model have an idealized version of how you think files should work. And then what QuickCheck does in its random generation, it generates a random sequence of actions that you can perform on your system. So in the example of a file system, it would randomly generate a sequence of opening files, closing files, writing to files, reading files, and so on. And now you can basically step this model and the system in parallel. So you have some sort of action that you perform in the real world, and you apply the same type of action to your model. And then after that, your real system has progressed into a new state, and your model has also been updated. And then after this step, you can compare the two and check whether they are still in sync. And you continue this for several steps. So when our first quick check example, we generated random list of ints. The idea for testing a real world system is to generate random lists of actions and then apply those actions both to a model and to the real system and compare that the results are as expected and that the model and the real system stay in sync. And shrinking in this case would be if you have a list of actions that shows that there's a bug in your system, then you can, for example, drop some of the actions and see whether the problem still arises and try making this action list shorter until you can't drop any more actions from the list and still reproduce the bug. And this is exactly how the Quick Check support for Plutus also works. So in order to test the Plutus contract, we have to come up with a model and define our expectations, how the various endpoints, for example, would change the model and provide a link between the model and the real system. Or actually, it's not the real blockchain, it's the emulator, but in a sense that is like a real system, and then apply this QuickCheck machinery. So that's what we will look at next for the example of our token sale contract. So the code for this is in module spec.model. And here we see we import Plutus contract test that we saw before that provides basic support for testing Plutus. And now to use this quick check approach, we also import Plutus contract test contract model, which has all the machinery to define a model and link it to the real contract. Furthermore, we have test.tasty and test.tasty quick check. Test.tasty.quick check provides a link between quick check and tasty so that you can use quick check properties in tasty test suites. So to define the model, first define a data type TS state for token sale state. So that's supposed to represent the state of one token sale instance. And it has three fields: the current price, the current supply of Lovelace in the UTXO in the contract, and the current supply of tokens in the contract. And now I define my model. That is now the model I was talking about in the diagram earlier. And that is just a map from wallet to token sale state. So the idea in this test is that I have several wallets, actually only two, and all the wallets run their own token sale. So we will have two wallets, and each of the wallets will run a token sale contract, and we will have two tokens, and the two wallets will trade different tokens. And the idea to use a map is that in the beginning, before the contract has started, there won't be an entry for that wallet, and once the contract has started, there will be an entry for that wallet with the current state. And I also implement lenses for that, because we also need optics in order to interact with the library, with this Bluetooth contract test contract model library. And now all the logic is in the instance of the type class contract model for this type. So here we provide how our model should behave and how it is linked to the actual contract. So the first we have a so-called associated data type. So that's quite an advanced Haskell feature. So in type classes, you can have, instead of just methods that we usually have, also have data types. We have actually seen that before when we define validators and we define this dummy type that provides a link between the datum type and the redeemer type. So there we also use these associated types. So we need an associated action type, which represents the actions that QuickCheck will generate. And in principle, I just have one constructor in this action type for each of the endpoints we said so earlier. I just have additional arguments because now there are different wallets at play and I must keep track which of the wallets performs an action. So start wallet means that this wallet starts a token sale contract. Then set price wallet integer means that this wallet, the second one, sets the price for the token sale operated by the first one, and it sets the price to this integer. Of course, we know from the contract logic that this should only work if these two wallets are the same, because only the owner of the token sale can actually set the price. But to make it more interesting, I want to provide actions also if somebody else tries to, and then we can see whether this is actually not working, because we expect that nobody else can set the price of token sale owned by a different wallet. Same for add tokens. So again, add tokens, this wallet wants to add tokens to that wallet's token sale and this many tokens. Then withdraw, this wallet wants to withdraw so many tokens and so many ADA from the token sale run by this wallet. That should again fail if the two wallets are not the same. And finally, buy tokens. So this wallet wants to buy from that wallet's token sale this amount of tokens. Okay, so this is the first ingredient that we need, this type of actions. The second ingredient is another associated data type. It's called contract instance key. So the idea is for each instance of a contract that we are running, we want a key that identifies this instance. And this is actually a so-called general algebraic data type. So it's a little bit different format to usual data declarations in Haskell that look like this. So the idea is that instead of just providing the constructors, you write them in this form, basically with their type signature. So this means we have a constructor start key that takes a wallet as an argument and then produces something of this type. And the reason we need these GADTs here, or the point of GADTs, generalized algebraic data types, is that with normal data types, the type parameters are always the same for all constructors. So if we have a parameterized type like list, for example, list of A's, then all the constructors that we have will produce a list of the same type A. And generalized algebraic data types allow us to have different type parameters. And we need this in this case because our contracts potentially can have different type parameters. So in this case, there are two types of instances. Recall we had these, the start contract and the use contract, and they had different type signatures. And so I provide one sort of key that I call start key for the first type, for the start contract, and it just basically as an argument has the wallet that does the starting. And here we see, so the type parameters are, the first one is the model we are just defining, and then the ones that come from the contract itself. So the state type, which is last token sale, if you recall in this case, then the schema, and text is the error type. And then there's the second type of contracts, the use type. And so I provide the instance key for that as well, that I call use key. And that takes two wallets as parameters. This is the one that owns the token sale we are interacting with. And that is the one that actually runs the contract. So similar to how it worked here. So same order of wallets. And this has different type parameters. Again, TS model, but there is no state. We don't use tel. And the schema is different. The error type is the same. Next, we need to somehow provide this instance tag function, which, given such a key that we just defined and a wallet, a so-called instance tag or contract instance tag. And because we already know the wallet that runs the instance, because that was one of the arguments to our contract instance keys, we can ignore this wallet argument. And this instance tag type or contract instance tag type doesn't have an accessible constructor, but it implements the is string class. And we haven't seen that class before explicitly, but we have used it all the time when we use this GHC extension for overloaded strings. So when we can use string literals to, for example, define a byte string or a token name or a currency symbol, all those types implement is string and they allow using string literals. And the way that is actually implemented is via a type class called isString. And that in particular has a method from string. So given a string, it converts a string into that type. And this constant instance tag type implements isString. Therefore, if we provide a string, we can construct something of that type. So the idea here is to simply use our key that we have here and show it, because it implements show, and then write instance tag for some arbitrary text in front of that. I mean, that wouldn't be necessary. I just copied that from some code from the libraries where they do it like that as well. So it is just important that this instance tag function results in a different tag for each instance that we will ever run in our simulation or in our tests. And this is guaranteed here because the way these are set up. So we will have one start instance for each wallet and then one use instance for each pair of wallets. But of course, they are all different values of this contract instance key TS model type. And then when we show them, they will still all be different. And that's the important part here. Actually, there is a default implementation for the instance tag method of the contract model class. So you normally don't have to implement that yourself, but that default only works, at least right now, if you only have at most one contract instance per wallet. But this is not the case in our case, because we will have three per wallet. One start instance and two use instances using the own token sale and the other wallet's token sale. So we have three contracts running per wallet, and therefore we are forced to implement that ourselves, this instance tag function. So the next one, arbitrary action, as the name suggests, is supposed to generate an arbitrary action. So action we defined here, and we must now tell the system how to generate a random action. And as argument, it gets the model state. We come to that later. But I don't need that here, and I can ignore it. One off is one of the combinators provided by QuickCheck. And given a list of arbitrary actions, it randomly picks one of those. So the idea is I basically just provide a list to create random actions of these types using these constructors, and then pick randomly one of those. And this is using something that we also haven't seen before. It's so-called applicative style. So recall when we introduced monads, I mentioned that monad as a superclass has applicative, but we haven't used applicative yet. And applicative is often very useful to write monadic code more compact. So basically, what this says is first run the monadic gen wallet action. which I should show first. This is here. So what this is supposed to do, it's in this quick check gen monad, this random generation monad, generate a random wallet. And how do I do that? I use yet another combinator provided by QuickCheck elements that simply takes a list of values of the type I want to generate and then picks a random of those elements. So wallets is another helper I defined somewhere here. Here, so wallets is just wallet one, wallet two. So it's just this two element list. So gen wallet will just randomly either pick wallet one or wallet two. Okay, so what this means is we first use this gen wallet to generate a random wallet and then return the action start that wallet that we just picked. And this is just a more compact way to write it. This, of course, this operator we have seen before, this fmap, which comes from the functor class. So gen wallet is of type gen, capital gen wallet. And start, as we see here, start is takes a wallet and returns an action. So if we fmap that, we get something of type gen wallet to gen action. So the result is something of type gen action as we want. So it's a random action. And here for set price, we must pick three random arguments. So set price takes two wallets and an integer. So we use gen wallet twice to pick two random wallets for these two wallet arguments, and then gen non neck, which is also defined here as a helper function, which randomly generates an integer but a non-negative one. And actually, that is there is something in the quick check libraries to support this. There's a non-negative type that implements an arbitrary instance. And it's just a new type wrapper around integer, and with get non-negative, I can extract the integer. So this arbitrary comes from the non-negative type that would generate something of type non-negative, but that just wraps an integer, and I extract that integer with this get non-negative. Anyway, so this generates a non-negative random integer. Okay, and this is now where this applicative style really shines. So if I wrote that in a do block, for example, I would first call gen wallet and bind the result against something, whatever, W1. Then I would call gen wallet again and bind the result against something like W2. Then I would call gen non neck, bind the result against P. And then finally, I would return set price W1, W2. And using this operator, which comes from the applicative class, we can write this nicely and compactly like this. So conceptually, applicative is weaker than monad, and you can always use this applicative style if what you are doing, the actions in the monad you are invoking, don't depend on the result of previous actions. So in a do block, I can have some monadic action and then inspect the result, and depending on what the result is, do the one thing or the other. And that is not possible in applicative, but often monadic code doesn't make use of that power, and then we have this more compact way of writing it. But it's really just identical to using a do block, it's just more compact. Anyway, and I follow this same schema for the other constructors. So again, this one-off will randomly pick one of these lines and then so decide on one constructor for an action to pick. So it will randomly pick a start action, a set price action, an add tokens action, buy tokens action, or withdraw action. And then once it has picked one, it will generate the random arguments for that constructor. Depending on what constructor it is, might be different types or number of arguments. So withdraw takes two random wallets and then two integers, non-negative integers, for how many tokens I want to withdraw and how many loveless I want to withdraw. I can try this out in the REPL. So using sample that we saw before, and then I sample this arbitrary action that I just defined. I don't have this model state, but I know I'm not looking at it, so I can just use undefined. and let's see. And I get a couple of randomly generated actions. And we see that it indeed picks different constructors, and then for those constructors picks random arguments. For example, here's withdraw wallet1, wallet1, 3, 5. And here we have another withdraw wallet1, wallet2, 1, 2, and so on. Next is initial state. As the name suggests, it's the initial state of our model. Recall the model was this map from wallets to tokens held states. And in the beginning, there won't be any tokens held yet. So it's just the empty map. So the initial state is the model that has the empty map, which means no tokens held has started yet. Now comes the most complex function that we must implement to set this up, and that's called next state. And if you recall the diagram, I said you must know what effect performing an action has on the model, and that's exactly what this next state function does. If we look at the type of next state, we see it takes an action and returns something in yet another monad. It's called the spec monad. And that basically allows us, that monad allows us to inspect our current state, so the current state of our model, and also to transfer funds in our model. So this is not real funds on the real blockchain or in the emulator, but the model, among other things, also knows how many funds each wallet currently holds, and we can shift that. So let's look at an example. Let's first look at the effect of the start action. So one effect is that now the model state should change. Recall the model is this new type wrapper around a map, and in the map we have an entry for every wallet which is in the map if the corresponding token sale has started. So what we have to do is we have to create this entry in the map for wallet W. And this is exactly what this line does. So this operator here comes from the spec monad, and it takes a lens from the model to somewhere on the left-hand side, and then sets that focus of that lens to the entry on the right-hand side. So this here on the left-hand side is an optic, and TS model goes from our model to the map, and this at comes from the lens library, and that is something that works nicely with maps. And what it does is at key, so if you have a map from key to values, then at key zooms in from the map to the entry at that key. However, the entry could not be there. So actually the target type of this at lens is maybe value. So if it's there, it will be adjusted. If it's not there, it will be nothing. And this is a proper lens, so you can not only look up entries, you can also set entries. So if you use this lens, this at lens to set, to just, then you create an entry at that key. And if you set to nothing, you would delete the entry at that key. So the combination of these two lenses now zooms in from our state to the entry at wallet W. And we want to set it to this. So by starting the token sale, now there should be an entry. And that entry should be this TSS state. Recall these were the price and the amount of tokens and the amount of Loveless. So in the beginning, when we just start the token sale, all three values are zero. So what this line does in the spec monad is it will change the model and set the entry in the map at wallet W to this token sale with zero price and no tokens and no Loveless included. The second line, wait, also comes from the spec monad. So the spec monad also has a concept of the passing of time. So we basically wait for one step, one block, or one slot. I mean, in reality, in the real blockchain, there's only one block every 20 slots on average. But here, wait one basically means we wait one step, we wait until the next block. So the starting of the token sale should basically be one transaction, which it is. If you recall how it was implemented, it just sends this UTXO or creates this UTXO at the state machine address. This wouldn't be true if we use a real thread token, because in that case, the thread token first has to be minted, which also takes at least one step, probably exactly one step. So in that case, it would take two steps, but we will not use this thread token mechanism, as I mentioned earlier. So this starting really should take one step. So the white one is enough. So what this now says is that after the start action, the model should be changed so that now in the map at wallet W, there is this entry and one time step should have passed. Now the second case, set price. So set price to the token sale run by wallet V, and the price setter is wallet W, and the new price is P. So when comes control monad, and as the name suggests, so it takes a boolean, and if the boolean is true, then the second argument will be executed in the monad, and if it's false, this will simply be ignored and nothing happens. So what we say is if somebody tries to set the price that's not the owner of the token sale, nothing will happen. Only time will pass. But if the owner tries to set the price, then the model will be updated. And this is now a bit similar to this lens here. But instead of at, we use IX. So at is a lens. And the target type is maybe the type of values in the map. IX is a traversal. And so if the key is there, then it will focus on the value of that with that key. But if the key is not there, then it simply won't focus on anything. And then this TSS price, given the value, will zoom into the price component. So that means if there is an entry for wallet V, so if wallet V has started the token sale, then we will set the price to P. And if wallet V hasn't started the token sale yet, then nothing will happen. Let's play a bit with at and IX in the REPL to see the difference and how they work. So first I need to import control lens. And because I want to play with maps, I also need data.map strict, and let's qualify it. Okay, and let's have a simple example map. So let's take a map with string keys, let's say has, and boolean values. Like this. Okay, and now for example, we can first play with at. So I can, for example, view the focus of the at lens at key, let's say Haskell, and it gives me just true. So the just because the key is present and then the value true. If I try this with a key that's not present, then I will get nothing. And I can also use it to set. So for example, I can try this. So by setting the at lens at key Python to just false, I'm inserting this value into the map. If I instead use Haskell to just false, then now I've updated the key. It used to be Haskell true, now it's Haskell false. And finally, if I set to nothing, I'm removing the key Haskell from the map. Now for IX, it's different. So if I try to set IX Haskell to false, that should work. So I can update, but if I try this with Python, then simply nothing will happen. So this IX is a traversal, and it will focus one by one on all keys given here, which of course can only happen 0 or 1. So either the key is there, then it will focus on that, or the key is not there, then it will simply not focus on anything. So if I use an existing key, I can use this to update. But if I use a key that doesn't exist, then simply nothing will happen. Okay, the next step is add tokens. So wallet W tries to add tokens to the token cells started by wallet V, and the amount of tokens is N. So first we check whether the token cell has started, and for that we use a helper function. So let's look at that first. It's actually these three helper functions here. So the first one, get token cell state prime, takes a model state and a wallet and returns maybe the token cell state. And how does it do that? So it takes this model state and then uses the operator to, which takes a lens to zoom in and look up the value. So contract state goes from a model state to the actual model. So this is now the type we defined. Then this TS model comes from us, so that takes the model and gives us the map. And finally, again, the add, which given the map and the key, gives us maybe the value. So this is a simple application of optics. Now this get TS state does the same thing, but in the spec monad, so only given the wallet. And how does it do that? Well, in the spec monad, there is an operation called get model state, which allows us to get the model state. So we get the model state, and then we use our first helper function to get maybe to the TS state for the given wallet. And then finally, we can implement our has started, also taking a wallet, and also in the spec monad, which returns a bool. And there we simply use this get TSS state that we just defined, but we don't care about the value of the TS state. We just care whether it's a just or nothing. If it's a just, then the entry is there in the map, and if it's a nothing, it's not. So there's a standard function from data.maybe is just, which checks exactly that. And I have to fmap it because this here happens in the spec monad. So I have to lift the is just into the spec monad. So has started V in the spec monad given a wallet will tell me whether the entry in the map corresponding to V is in the model, and that means that the token sale has started. Okay, so this is the first line. So we check whether the token sale has started. And if it hasn't, then we simply don't do anything and just wait one step. But if it has started, and if we want to add a positive amount of tokens, so if this n is not zero or negative, then we first ask for the balance change. We can look at this ask model state in the REPL, ask for information, and we see that it takes a function from model state to A and then returns it A. So what it will do is it will look up the current model state in the spec monad, then apply this given function to it and return the result. And the model state itself, I asked for its information here, and it looks a bit unwieldy. That's because none of these things are exported, so they are all fully qualified here in the display. But nevertheless, we see model state is parameterized by one type parameter, and that incidentally will be our custom state that we defined. So in our case, it's this map from wallets to TS states. And one of the fields in the model state is indeed that. That's why I could use the contract state lens earlier to zoom into that. But there is also more information. So current slot, last slot, balances, changes, and minted. So that's the information we have. And there are all lenses available to get to these. In particular, for this balance changes. We have an optic. It's not a lens, it's just a getter, so that means you can't set anything, you can just view it. And so it's a optic from model state to a value. And this indicates how much the value, the balance of the wallet has changed during the course of the simulation, during the course of the spec computation. Before we go back to the next state function, let's briefly look at some helper functions that I defined. So wallets are the wallets I'm using, so wallet 1, wallet 2. Then the idea is that wallet 1 will sell a different token than wallet 2 in its token sale. So I define two currency symbols, AA and BB, and two token names, A and B. So the idea is wallet 1 will sell token AAA and wallet 2 will sell token BBB. So these are the currency symbols, these are the token names, these are the asset classes. This is actually the token sale parameter for the two wallets. So it has the wallet's public key, and then I look up in this tokens map the correct token that's on sale. And as I said before, I'm not using the thread token mechanism, so I provide nothing here. Finally, there's this constant token amount, 1000. So when we set up the simulation, we specify an initial distribution, and I give everyone 1000 ADA and 1000, that's this token amount, of both tokens. So both wallets will have 1000 ADA and 1000 of the AAA token and 1000 of the BBB token. So if we now go back to next state, to the case where we were at tokens, so we already discussed this line and this one. Now we were here. So what this does, it asks for the model state, and then view is just a function that you can use instead of this caret dot operator. So to get the result of zooming into an optic. So what this line does, it tells us how much did the balance of wallet W change. Then I just explain this tokens map. So this is the token that wallet V is selling. And now we want to check that actually wallet W has N tokens to add. So that's why we need all this information. So we just calculate whether it has enough tokens. So token amount, which is 1000, is how many tokens it had in the beginning. Then we use this balance change and add that to the initial amount. So maybe wallet W now has more or less tokens. So this is captured here in the BC in the balance change. So the sum is how many of those tokens wallet W has at this moment. And well, it must be greater or equal than the amount of tokens it wants to add. Okay, so if all these conditions are satisfied, then what will happen is wallet W will add these tokens. So they will disappear out of the wallet. And for that, we have another function in the spec monad. It's called withdraw. So the concept is a simplified version of what's really going on. So in the spec monad, every wallet has a certain balance, a value, and it can withdraw from that balance or add to it, deposit. So later we'll see a case of deposit. But other addresses are not modeled in the spec monad. So that's like a black box. So there are only the wallets and this black box. So it doesn't matter where the funds disappear to, they just disappear out of the wallet. So withdraw means after this step, wallet W should have N tokens less because they have been added to the contract. And finally, we update the model state. So again, we use an optic, so TS model to get to our map, and IXV to get to the token sale run by V, then TSS token to zoom into the field that tells us how many tokens are at the UTXO at the moment. And this is another operator coming from the spec monad. So instead of setting, assigning what we saw earlier, if we use this dollar tilde operator, we can specify a function and then that function will be applied. So plus n means we increase in the model this value, how many tokens are in the token sale run by v by n. So the n tokens disappear from wallet w and they are now in the model accounted for because we increased the number in the model by n. And finally, we wait one step. The next case is by tokens. So from the token sale run by v, w wants to buy n tokens. So first we check that n is positive, and if not, we just wait. If it is, we use the helper function we just discussed to get maybe the token sale. So if that is nothing, then v hasn't started the token sale yet, so we also don't do anything. But if it is just t, and if there are at least n tokens on sale, then we look up the price, calculate the total price, so the price per token times the number of tokens. Then we use withdraw again to take this total price out of the wallet of W. And then we use deposit that I mentioned earlier, which puts money back into a wallet to put the n bought tokens into the wallet. And finally, we have to update the model. So we have to increase the amount of loveless by L and decrease the amount of tokens by N. Finally, we have the withdraw case. So token sale run by V, wallet W wants to withdraw N tokens and L loveless. So first we check that W equals V because only the owner of the token sale can withdraw. If not, we don't do anything and just wait. So if that condition is satisfied, we look up the state again, and if it's nothing, then we know the token sale hasn't started, so there's nothing to withdraw. But if it's just, we check that there are at least n tokens and at least l loveless, otherwise we also don't do anything. And now we deposit the loveless and the tokens back in the wallet, and we update the state. So we remove the loveless and we remove the tokens. And that completes the next state function. So this is, as I said, the most complex one to set up this model, to describe the effect the actions should have on the model. So right now the model is just some conceptual model that has nothing to do with the actual contracts we wrote earlier. I mean, the names, of course, are suggestive. I gave the names the same names as were used in the Redeemer, but there is no link whatsoever until now between this model here and the actual contracts and the actual endpoints we wrote. And this link is provided by yet another method in this class that we have to implement, and that's the perform function. If we check the type of perform in the REPL, we see it takes something called handle fun state. I'll explain that in a moment. Then it takes the model state and it takes the action we are performing. And I don't need the model state in this example. The handle will give me access to the actual contract handles. So let's see, look at an example. So we make a pattern match on the, or case distinction on the command. So if it's start W, so that means the action is starting the start contract for wallet W. And now this is now the link. So this is now actual emulator code. So how would this action manifest itself in the emulator? So in order to do this, I must call the start endpoint on W, and recall the argument I need here is this instance. So in the emulator, I start a contract instance and I get a handle, and now I must provide this handle. And this is exactly what the first argument is for. So this H argument, given a key, These are the keys, these contract instance keys we defined earlier. So given a key, it will give me the handle that I need to give to call endpoint in order to actually reach the right contract instance. And in this case, the key is start key W. That's exactly what we defined this key for the start contract on the W wallet. So giving that to the H we get a handle that we can provide to the call endpoint function. And now we must provide the arguments. So this triple consisting of the currency symbol of the token we are selling, the token name of the token we are selling, and then true or false depending on whether we want to use the threat token mechanism. And as I said several times now already, we don't want to use it in this test, so we provide false. And additionally, I do a delay of one slot afterwards. And this delay is just, it's nothing new, just a helper function here, which uses our well-known wait n slots that we have used all the time already. So just a shorter word of that. Okay, and all the others are in principle very similar. So, for example, set price calls the set price endpoint, but now the key is not a start key, it's a use key. And because we want to set price, wallet W wants to set a price on the token sale provided by V, this is exactly why we use key VW here. And the argument is P. And the others are exactly the same, other endpoints. Finally, and this is now the last method I must provide to implement all of this, is precondition. So I have the option to say that certain actions are not supposed to be randomly generated at a certain point. So I can define preconditions under which it is acceptable to provide this action. And the preconditions I define here is that I say, okay, start. The precondition for start is that the model that this token sale hasn't yet started. So the S, the first argument of precondition, is again this model state. So precondition model state action is a condition that I can put that says, okay, in this state is this action possible. So this says start is only possible if I haven't yet started the token sale for wallet W. And for the others, I do the opposite. So I say this is only possible if it has already started. Okay, and this now finally completes the definition of this contract model class for our TS model. And now there's just, I need eek and show instances for my contract instance key type. And I want to derive them, but because it's a GADT, sometimes deriving doesn't work as nicely as it does with other Haskell data types. But there's something called standalone deriving. So instead of writing this deriving eek or deriving show directly into the, behind the data type definition, I can have this standalone lines. And the syntax is like this, deriving instance eek and deriving instance show. And that needs actually a GHT extension, standalone deriving. Okay, and I think that is it. So now, not quite. So this sets up everything. One more thing we need, we must provide the instance specs we actually want to run. So we defined these keys, but now we must somehow link them to actual contracts that we haven't done yet. And this happens here. So this is a list of contract instances we want to run. And such a contract instance spec type takes three arguments. The first is the key, the second is the wallet, and the third is the actual contract that is supposed to be invoked with that. So we have two cases. We have the start keys and the use keys. So for the start key W, so that's the key, the wallet is W. And the associated contract is the start endpoint. And we do this for both wallets. And the use keys, so the key is use key VW. The wallet it runs on is W. And the contract is use endpoints, and recall use endpoints takes a parameter, namely the token sale. So we look up the token sale belonging to wallet V. And we do this for all pairs of wallets. So there will be four of these instances and two of those. And this we have seen, this we have seen. And now finally, we can define a quick check property. So this is now the link between all of this work, between this model and quick check. And there's a function in plutus.contract.test prop run action with options. So if we check the type of prop run actions with options, we see first it takes the check options type that we have seen before when we did the emulator trace based testing. Then it takes this instance spec, so the contract instances we want to run. Then it takes something from model state to trace predicate. So this would allow us to insert additional tests. And finally, it produces a function from actions, which is basically just a list of actions, to property. Property is like a beefed up bool. You can think bool of that. It's a quick check thing. So it's a boolean that has some additional capabilities for, it's mostly for logging and debugging. So how do we use this here? So as options, we use the same as before, which allows us to specify the initial coin distributions. And what we do is we get each wallet 1,000 ADA and 1,000 of both tokens A and B. Okay, as second argument, we provide these instance specs that we defined above, and we don't add any additional checks. So this is just pure, true. True is just another word for return. It comes from applicative. If you check again, so we provide the first three arguments. So the result of this is now a function from action state to property. And provided QuickCheck can compute random actions, it will be able to test that. So this is now something QuickCheck can handle. So we can actually try this. And we can use sample to generate us sample action sequences. So, and again, we see this pattern that we saw with intlist before, that it starts simple and gets more and more complex. So the first one here would just have one action. It would just start the token sale for wallet two. Second and third would even be the empty list, so no actions whatsoever. And then we see a more complex scenario. Start the token sale for wallet two, start the token sale for wallet one. Then wallet two tries to add six tokens to its own token sale. Then wallet one tries to set the price of wallet two's token sale, and so on. And we see that we get quite complex scenarios. And what will this property be? I mean, what will be tested? Well, it will be tested, what I tried to explain in the diagram, that for all these randomly generated action sequences, the properties we specified in the model, so how the funds flow, correspond to what actually happens in the emulator. And if there is a discrepancy, then the test will fail. We can actually try this with quick check prop TS, so which is called test here. And we see tests are run, but we also see that it takes quite a while. So now it has run 18 tests and it will run 100. Probably it's more interesting to implement a bug in the actual code and see whether these tests will find it. For example, here in the set price case, as a constraint, we had that must be signed by the seller. So only the seller can set the price. But let's say we forgot that, so we forgot this constraint. So if I run the test again with this wrong code now, then we see that QuickCheck indeed found a bug. And we see it did 19 tests in this case and 5 shrinks. So it simplified the action sequence that it originally found and that produced a bug. So let's look at this action sequence. So first wallet 2 starts a token sale. Then wallet 1 sets the price of wallet 2's token sale to 18. Now recall in the model, we specified that in this case nothing should happen. Setting the price should only change anything if the wallet that started the sale actually changes it. But now in the actual implementation, we remove this check, so we forgot the check. So this will actually have an effect and indeed set the price to 18. So now wallet 2 adds 14 tokens and then adds another 9 tokens and finally buys from its own token sale 17. So according to the model, the price is still zero, so these 17 should be for free. So there are, what is it, 23 in the sale and then 17 bought back. So 6 should still be in the sale, 17 back in the wallet, but no ADA should have been spent, no Lovelace should have been spent because the price should still be zero. So expected from the point of view of the model is that there are 6 token Bs less now. That's correct, 23 minus 17. And the fees are ignored and no effect on the Lovelace. But the actual code found that 306 Lovelace were spent. So probably 18 times 17. Let's see. So 18 times 17. Yes, that's 306. So in the real implementation, now the price was set to 18, and so for this buying, wallet one had to pay 306 Lovelace that are now missing from the wallet. So there's a discrepancy between the expectation from the model and the actual funds in the wallet with the actual implementation. And QuickCheck has spotted the discrepancy and reported it. And so this is very nice. So we get the action sequence, we get the discrepancy, and we also get the emulator log of this run. Now, by default, this is all that the QuickCheck tests do. So it only checks the flow of funds, whether that agrees at each point with what we specified in the model. But it is possible to add additional checks. And it is also possible to influence these action sequences. So right now they are just random actions, of course, checking the preconditions that we defined. But it's also possible to do some more unit test-like scenarios where we specify certain flows of actions to steer the tests into certain directions. So that's called dynamic logic, and it's yet another monad, but I think that would go too far to talk about this now. And I should mention that, of course, this, even though it's very powerful, also has its limitations. So one thing is that, of course, it only tests the contracts that we provide. It doesn't test all possible off-chain code. So, of course, it's possible that with the provided off-chain code that we write, everything is fine, but some party could write their own off-chain code that allows them to steal funds from our contract. And obviously, this QuickCheck model can't detect that because it has to use the contracts we give it in the perform method. And the second problem is concurrency. I mean, we carefully added this delay of one slot to each action to make sure that everything is nicely sequenced. So all the actions happen in sequence. But of course, in the real blockchain or also in the emulator, wallets can have concurrent submissions of transactions. And in principle, we could try to do that with this model as well, but then we somehow must in the model specify what should happen in this case. And that might really depend on in which order the transactions are processed and so on. So that might get very complicated. So there are limitations, but nevertheless, it's a powerful way to test Pluto's contracts. Finally, I should mention how all of this integrates with Tasty, and there's a function coming from the Tasty library called test property that takes a description, a string, and then a quick check property. So we can use our prop underscore TS here, and now we get a test tree that Tasty can understand. Actually, how this is now set up, if we look at the Cabal file, so we have the library with the three models we saw, the token sale and the quick check and the lens examples. And I provided an additional stanza in the Cabal file that's now not library and not executable, what we have seen before, but a test suite. And this means that the tests work by running executables, and if there's an exit code that's not zero, the test counts as failed. So the rest is quite similar to how we specify an executable in a Cabal file. So we provide a main. This is spec.hs. I haven't shown you that yet. And folder, other modules. So these are the two test models we have looked at. So this is the one with the emulator trace. This is the one we discussed just now. So let's finally look at this spec.hs. And this simply imports the two modules that contain the test and Tasty, and use this default main and set up a test tree. I can again provide some name, and then just uses the tests we defined for the emulator trace and the test we now defined for the model. And all of this can then from the command line be run with Cabal test. If we do that, then after compiling, it will run all the tests. So in our case, two, the emulator trace test and the quick check test. For homework, I want you to modify the token sale contract to accept an additional transition called close that can be called by the seller and only by the seller to actually close the contract, close the UTXO, collect all the remaining tokens and Loveless in the contract and the NFT. And this time I don't provide an extra module for that. So you can either just modify this token sale module or copy it and create a new module with this separate logic. Of course, you will have to think about the datum type. So right now it was integer, but now we have this new state, this closed state. So one option would be to use maybe integer instead, where just some integer, just price means the contract is still active and nothing means it has been closed. And if you feel ambitious, you can also modify the trace and the model in order to accommodate for this additional operation. So for the model, you could act a new action close. And for the trace, for the emulator trace as well, as a last step, provide the close action.